so today you want us to cover this topic, just to see what entails and how we expect the exam to be, or expect the questions in exam. So this is a topic which is common in both section 4 and section 6, and it's important to know under this topic you need to know what is the objective of an audit before, though sometimes I covered it back, but you need to understand the objective of an audit. And in simple, objective of an audit is to enable the auditor to do what? Express an opinion on whether the financial statements gives a true and fair view. So that is the objective of an audit. And before the auditor expresses an opinion, we have some factors the auditor must ascertain or consider. Because now I have my student with me, I think she can recall one of the factors to consider before expressing an opinion. Because you have seen that is the objective of an audit. Yes, I'm in agreement, but we need to know. You cannot just give a judgment as the auditor without some basics or some foundations or some of the matters being considered. So that is why I want us, at least we understand some of the matters the auditor should consider before he gives or expresses an opinion. And I'll start by giving the first one. The auditor must ascertain whether the company has kept proper books. So that is number one. Number two.
The auditor.
Yes.
Should consider the nature of the audit.
That is a total lie. I want to have these matters here. You see, number one, the auditor must consider whether the company has kept proper books of accounts. So remember, auditor is expressing an opinion. You cannot just say you are giving a conclusion without some of these bases, some of the matters being taken into consideration. You must review the books of the company. If they are in order, then you can say you can give the best opinion. If they are not in order, you can just modify your report accordingly. Another one is that auditor must ascertain whether the financial statements, whether the financial statements are in agreement. Whether the financial statements are in agreement with the books of accounts. So that is another matter the auditor needs to consider before he gives or he expresses his opinion, whether the books or the financial statements are in agreement with the books of accounts. Remember, if any transaction takes place in a company, there must be a voucher. And from the vouchers, we prepare the books of accounts. And then after preparing the books of accounts, it is from these books of accounts we prepare financial statements. So the financial statement prepared, they should or they need to agree with the books, and not the books agreeing with the financial statements. If you know accounting, whenever there's a transaction, we start from the vouchers, books of accounts, then financial statements. So that is why the financial statements, the information found in the financial statements, it is obtained from these books. So the financial statements, they must agree with the books of accounts. For the auditor to express an opinion, he must consider whether they are agreeing or they are not agreeing. Another thing the auditor needs to ascertain or consider, he must consider whether financial statements are in agreement. Whether financial statements are in agreement with the GAAPs, that is generally acceptable accounting principles, or the general accepted accounting principles. Remember, we prepare the financial statements based on the accounting principles. So for the auditor to give an opinion, or before he gives his judgment, he must consider or ascertain whether the financial statements, they are in agreement with the GAAPs, some of the principles of accounting. Another thing, whether He has, that is whether the auditor has received adequate returns from branches not visited. Adequate returns from branches not visited. So auditor must also consider whether all the, he has received returns from branches which he has not visited. And the truth is, when you're auditing group of accounts, you may not be in a position to visit all the branches. So the ones which you have not managed to visit, you need the information, you need to be furnished with that information. You need to be given the returns or to receive those returns from them. So you must ascertain whether you have been given returns from those branches which you as the auditor, you were unable to visit. So that is a matter to consider. And again, you must, as the auditor, you must ascertain whether adequate information, and explanation has been received or obtained, which are considered to be necessary for the audit, So these are the five matters the auditor needs to ascertain or to consider. And now, after the auditor has ascertained all these, the five matters, if he is now in agreement with everything, or if the, all these matters are observed, or he is in agreement with the five matters, then he needs to give the best opinion of them all. And remember, you have different types of opinions, but the best of them all is an unqualified opinion. So the auditor, when he is satisfied by these matters, then he shall express an unqualified opinion on the financial statements. Otherwise, auditor shall modify the report accordingly, because we have other opinions. Remember, we have another one called the adverse opinion, which is not a very good opinion, but it is the worst type of opinion the auditor can give. That is adverse opinion, which is given where there is a disagreement with the management, and the disagreement is so material and pervasive. We also have another type of opinion. I'm just reviewing them. I'm just mentioning some of them. I'm not going into details. Later I shall cover that topic. So we have another one called qualified opinion. Qualified opinion can be given under two circumstances. One, where there is a disagreement, and two, where there is scope limitation. So if there is a disagreement and that disagreement is not so material, then you give qualified opinion, or then the auditor shall give qualified opinion. If there is a scope limitation, meaning there are some procedures the auditor wanted to perform, but he cannot perform them, then the auditor shall express qualified opinion where there is a scope limitation, but the scope limitation is not so material and pervasive. Then the other one is called a disclaimer of opinion. Disclaimer of opinion is given when there is scope limitation, and the scope limitation is so material and pervasive. So where there is scope limitation, the opinions to give are two. One of the opinion is qualified opinion, which is given where the scope limitation is not so material and pervasive. Then another one which can be given when there is a scope limitation, it is the disclaimer of opinion, and it is given where the scope limitation is so material and pervasive. Then we have now under disagreement with management. Disagreement may come in the application of the accounting principles, company policies being misapplied, etc., etc. So whenever there's a disagreement between the auditor and the management, the opinions the auditor can give are again two. One of the opinion is the adverse opinion, which is given where the disagreement is so material. I've said adverse is given where the disagreement is so material. Then the other opinion is qualified, which can be given, and it will be given if that disagreement is not so material. So that is just a brief summary of reporting, but later we shall cover that bit or that topic. So now, after we have understood the objective of an audit and we have said it is to enable the auditor to express an opinion, we need now to go ahead and understand another concept here, which is the professional ethics, which you need to cover, and it is very important. You just be very keen with this professional ethics. It is commonly examined. For those who are doing CASNEP exams, please, make sure you understand the ethical principles, you know the fundamental principles, and you can explain them, even if they are brought in a case study question. Now, we just need to list them. I'll explain each of them. Professional ethics. These are just the principles, some of the principles regulating the accountancy profession, or the ethics which regulates the conduct and behavior of the accountants or professional accountants in public practice. And in Kenya, the accountancy profession is regulated by ISPAC, the Institute of Certified Public Accountants of Kenya. ISPAC is a body regulating the accountancy profession. And ISPAC is a member of IFAC, which is the International Federation of Accountants Council, which is the worldwide organization, again, regulating the accountancy profession in the world, and it acts as a spokesperson of the profession. The ethics given, we can list them as per the standards we have. One is integrity. Integrity is being sincere. So, in other terms, being sincere, honest, truthful. So that is integrity. So this principle requires, or this ethical principle requires, professional accountants or their auditors to be honest. But I know sometimes we have those who are not honest, but the principle requires that you need to be honest as an accountant, you need to be truthful, you need to be sincere, you need to be fair in all your dealings, both professional and business relationships with your clients. So that is integrity. Let us observe this principle. It can take people to places if you observe this principle of integrity, because accountants, they handle money, they work with finances, auditors, they will be involved in many financial matters. And due to that, let auditors observe this principle by being honest. Another one, we have independence. Independence means being free from influence. As the auditor or the professional accountant, he is doing his work. The profession requires that he should be very free from influence, either of management of the company or any other party. So auditor should not be influenced when making his judgments. So that is also very, very important to be noted. Meaning, the auditor needs to have the independence of mind and the independence of appearance. Remember, we normally say auditor should be and be seen to be free from any conflict of interest or any undue influence of management. That is why we have two forms of the auditor's independence. One is the independence of mind and the independence of appearance. Independence of mind is the state of mind of the auditor. State of mind of the auditor while carrying out an audit of financial statements. That he is an independent person. So that is the independence of mind. We also have independence of appearance. Independence of appearance, it is the perception how auditor is perceived and seen by other people or by third parties when he is doing the audit as an independent person. Because sometimes when auditor, he is having some either blood relationship, either relationship with the clients or the officers of the company by blood or by marriage, that impairs or compromises auditor's independence. So that's about independence.
And later I shall be explaining a concept under independence, which is the threat to the auditor's independence, and also talking about the factors compromising or impairing auditor's independence and how to also enhance independence of the auditor. So ensure that you continue following my YouTube channel. So we can proceed to the next one. We can proceed to the next one after independence. We can have professional or be professional knowledge. Do you care, like, knowledge, competence, do you care, and skills, competence, do you care, and skills, professional knowledge, competence, do you care, and skills? The term competence, or the word competence, means being what? Having the ability to perform a task from start to finish without unnecessarily involving other people. So this principle requires that professional accountants or auditors, they should not accept an assignment which they are not capable to perform. So they should have the ability to perform a task or the audit from start to finish without unnecessarily involving others. So it is known that it may be necessary to involve other people, like experts. That's why we have the work of an expert being covered also as part of our syllabus, and it is important to know whether you require an expert or not. So that is about the competence part. Then it also requires that auditor or the professional accountants should have the necessary skills and maintain them, and knowledge, skills and knowledge required so that they can give quality services to the client. So ensure that you are giving clients quality services. That is what the profession requires, or this ethical principle requires. So that is another one. We need to have another one called confidentiality. Confidentiality. This principle requires auditor to keep secrets. Please ensure that if you're an auditor, if you're an accountant, you should not disclose the company's professional, the company's confidential information to any person, to anyone, to third parties. You should even not take advantage of the company's confidential information. So auditors are required to maintain top secrets of the client's confidential information obtained in the course of the audit. Now, I want to ask a question here. I have a student who is present here in the studio, and she is Maureen. So Maureen, tell me circumstances under which an auditor may disclose the company's confidential information. Circumstances under which the auditor may disclose the company's confidential information. And one thing I know, she has been my student from section one. We started from the lower level, by the way, the part one, and then she managed to pass all the papers. She came and did part two. She managed to do all the papers where I was also teaching her QA quantitative analysis, and she was almost getting an award, but she did not manage to get that award. I'm hoping this time she'll get an award in section six.
Yes.
So I am want to ask her to remind me the circumstances under which an auditor may disclose the company's confidential information. Number one, give me one, Maureen.
Where the client is involved in criminal activities, such as money laundering.
Thank you so much. So where the client company is involved in those criminal activities, and she has said money laundering, also drug trafficking, etc., etc. So all those criminal activities, if the auditor becomes aware of them, he may end up telling, or he should tell the relevant authority. He can report the matter even to the police. So by reporting, he shall be disclosing the company's confidential information. Another one?
Where the information is in public interest.
Thank you so much. Where the information is in public interest. If the information is required by the public, you have no option. You must disclose the information. And we also have another one. Where the client has given consent for the information to be disclosed. So if the client has given consent to the auditor to disclose the information, the auditor may end up, or should go ahead undisclosed information. Again, if the information is required to be disclosed by the profession. So where is a professional duty to disclose such information, auditor must disclose the information. And also another circumstance is where the information is also or where there is a legal duty to do or to disclose such information. So please ensure you just go through them, understand them. You have said where the maybe the client has committed an act or is involved in criminal activities.